And we're back. Welcome to Off the Shelf Reviews, where we provide real-world reviews of primarily 1/6 scale collectible figures. So, what are we looking at today? The TBLeague, or Fison, 1/6 scale Horus Guardian of the Pharaoh in silver collectible action figure. We're going to do things a little bit differently in this review, as I recently posted a review of the 1/6 scale Anubis figure from TBLeague, which uses the same base body and has other similarities as well. However, I'll still discuss why this piece belongs in a collection, my likes and dislikes, and then I'll also rate the piece as a top shelf, middle shelf, or bottom shelf collectible. So let's get started. All right, before we get to the figure itself, a quick word on the packaging. The box, like other TBLeague figures, has a magnet attached front flap which removes to provide access to the figure and accessories. Everything is packed in soft but supportive foam sponge, and the figure comes as a partially dressed body with everything else separated. So, who is Horus? And more importantly, why would you want to own this in your collection?
Why? Why is that, sir?
Quick history lesson. In ancient Egyptian religion and mythology, Horus was the celestial falcon, the embodiment of kingship, and arguably the most important deity to the pharaohs. Although there are several different versions of Horus, he is typically viewed as the loyal prince who grew up to avenge his murdered father Osiris and take his place as the ruler of Egypt. Usually shown as a falcon-headed man, his reign as king was considered the model for all subsequent kings and pharaohs, and each king of Egypt was acclaimed as a living Horus here on Earth. The continual conflict between Horus and his uncle Seth was a recurring theme in ancient Egyptian mythology, and many temples are devoted to Horus. The eyes of Horus were of particular significance, with his right eye representing the sun and the left representing the moon.
This figure was released in early 2021 and was the second figure in TBLeague's Egyptian god line. So before I get into the figure, I want to talk a little bit more about the line itself, as they have previewed, pre-ordered, and released several figures this year. And to be honest, I think I'm more excited about this line than just about any other current figure line. It's a great break from Star Wars or Marvel Hot Toys figures, and I am into it.
Like any other manufacturer, TBLeague is clearly looking to maximize revenue, so they've started to reuse molds and parts. To start with, they're offering a gold and silver version of all of their Egyptian line, and have recently offered a new silver version of Anubis, as the original release was one and done. They've also offered several falcon-headed figures, the first being Horus, then a female deity named Month, and just recently released Ra, which I'll also be reviewing. Although these are all falcon-headed, each head is truly unique, but I've started to notice some reuse of hands and feet. However, they've also started to up the ante with more complex figure designs. They've announced new winged versions of Horus with new outfits, and the new Tutankhamun figure comes with a throne, and the new winged Horus figures also come with a diorama-style base, which can be integrated with the new base included with the silver version of Anubis. They've also offered a new Osiris figure, which not only has a silver and gold version, but is also available in green, which is the one to get, in my opinion. Although there are over 2,000 Egyptian deities to choose from, I'm really hoping for a Sobek, a Seth, and Thoth, as well as Isis, Bastet, and Sekhmet.
But back to this figure. Like Anubis, this figure comes packaged as a naked torso and upper body, with only the kilt, belt, and leg wraps and feet already on the figure. Everything like the heads, the hands, all other costumes and accessories are separate in the foam tray. So what you're seeing here is the figure fully dressed. Also, this is the silver version of Horus. When I spent time in Egypt, I noticed that Horus is almost always represented as a white falcon. So I felt that this silver version of this figure with the white clothing and more of a sort of a silver beak and silver accents better represented the character on my shelf. So what do we like about it? So what do we like about this figure? First, let's start with the head sculpts. Like the other figures of this line, this figure does come with two head sculpts, the first being a more of a stoic expression, and then the second head sculpt being a much more dynamic, aggressive sculpt. Now, in both cases, again, just phenomenal job on paintwork and sculpt details. When you look up at the headdress, you see all of these details and the inscriptions, the hieroglyphs. you'll see a little moon symbol on this figure. Now, with Horus, one of his eyes represented the moon, the other eye represented the sun. So it's interesting that this head and the more aggressive head both have moon symbols. But I did notice on the new winged version of Horus, they actually have a symbol for the sun. It's a red symbol instead. Even on the face, now just look at some of the details here. You'll notice that he even has the Eye of Horus, the very famous symbol that looks like the Eye of Ra or the Eye of Horus. He's got that sculpted in. He's got the silver beak, as I mentioned, all the excellent detail there. He's got these really interesting predator-style dreadlocks, I guess you could call them. He's got an armored neck, and just look at the details in the feathers. Just a beautiful, beautiful job all around. The eyes, everything. Now then, when you look at the more aggressive head sculpt, just like Anubis, and I mean, look at the detail in the mouth, the tongue, the gums, again, the beak, the extra ferocity in the eyes, and then the same detail everywhere else. Just a phenomenal, phenomenal head sculpt. And in both cases, both of these head sculpts, although they're hard plastic, they do match the color of the body very well. The dreadlocks are softer plastic, so they do move around when you're moving the head in different positions. Great, great sculpt. The body is the same one as the one they used for the Anubis figure, which is supposed to be based on the TBLeague M35 most muscular body. So it is the same, with the same amount of articulation, same great musculature detail, and same incredible posability. So I've said it before, TBLeague Fison do make the best bodies in the industry, and this one is no exception. Certainly the details are different. So if you take a look at these feet, obviously the feet are meant to look more like the claws or talons of a falcon. So that's very different from the Anubis figure, which had sandaled sort of claw feet. And then if you look at the hands, I've actually put two different hands on here so you get a better look at them, but they're three-fingered. And again, a bit more avian, if you want to call it that, than what's on the Anubis figure. And then they both have excellent detail, not only on the claws, but then other items like the rings. So excellent body, no complaints there. Really like this outfit as well. Another great job by TBLeague Fison. If you ever watched Denobi 2 or any of his YouTube reviews, he mentions that his kilt does not hang flat just due to the way it was packaged, and same goes with mine. It was definitely folded over during packaging, and so it doesn't really hang flat. But more importantly, with mine, the belt, which is lightly glued to the kilt, had actually come apart almost as soon as I took it out of the box, because it was just so lightly glued. It's not really a huge deal, but it does require more patience when posing the figure. But that being said, it's a very nice detail on the belt itself. There is detail, printed detail on the kilt. You'll notice that the material used for his clothing is different from Anubis, which I really like, because I like the fact that they differentiate the characters. Like Anubis, the Yusek or Wesek collar, I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing that correctly, very well painted, very well sculpted. There's detail on front and back. You'll also notice the armlets are different sculpt and different color and different painted from Anubis. And the wrappings around the biceps do have that printed on material. There's great detail, once again, in these wrist or forearm gauntlets, I should say. All the way around, awesome. Also great detail down here on these, I was going to say Roman style sandals, but since he doesn't really have any sandals on his feet, I guess these sort of shin protectors or shin guards. Again, beautiful detail. However, unlike the original version of Anubis, this figure of Horus comes with a cape. It's great. It's a wired and lined. So I'll show you the inner lining here. Again, beautiful detail, but it is wired so you can pose it as you wish. And you'll also notice it has some detail printed on the cape. Again, that same sort of thick material that's different to the Anubis figure. And then he even has this sort of fur collar that goes on top of the cape. Very, very well done. And I think that what's nice about the fur and the cape is that it really gives Horus a little bit more of a regal look, which is appropriate for the character as Horus was a prince. I'm also very happy with the accessories. I would list this second head sculpt as an accessory. He doesn't come with as much stuff as Anubis did, but that's fine considering the cost of the figure. He also comes with a multitude of hands, which, as I mentioned, are different from Anubis. Very well sculpted, very well painted. I mean, you can see the detail on the rings, the knuckles, the claws. Excellent job. He also comes with a very large kopesh, which is sort of an Egyptian sickle-style sword. Beautiful detail on the blade, on top of the blade. The pommel, again, very, very nicely done. Great paint job as well. And then lastly, he comes with a huge spear. So similar to Anubis, the staff or spear that these figures come with are really, really tall. But again, richly painted. Lots of sculpting detail along the staff. And then an Ankh symbol on top before the blade. Very, very, very well done. All of the accessories for this figure, nicely sculpted, nicely painted. Now for the dislikes. Very, very few. I mean, they're really nitpicks, if anything. So, like all the other basic TBLeague figures, this figure does not come with a stand of any kind. The stand you see here, this is a custom stand that I purchased from eBay. Although some of the newer sort of deluxe figures, like the Winged Horus figures and the new silver version of Anubis, do come with stands that are interesting and actually pretty nice. But again, depends on your shelf space whether you'd want to have those types of stands. And although the figure does hold poses very well, I do believe that a basic figure stand is required for all 1/6 figures. Lastly, the minuscule amount of glue that I mentioned that was holding the belt to the kilt really makes this part of the outfit very fragile. And, you know, that's really just a nitpick, though. I really don't have any issues with this figure whatsoever. Now it's time to rate this piece, but first, the shelf pose. Oh, yeah. So for a size comparison, I've added the original Anubis figure here, and the reason why I did that is because I don't know why, and I don't know if this is the case with everybody, but the Anubis figure and this horse figure should be on the same body, but for some reason, and I don't know if this is being picked up on camera, but the horse figure seems taller to me. Like if you sort of look down at the feet and scroll your way up, you'll notice the knees are roughly the same height and the waist is roughly the same height, but then all of a sudden the torso just seems slightly elongated or taller on the horse figure. It's certainly not just the head sculpt. And I don't know if that's just an optical illusion with my own eyes or if it's just due to the fur on the cape giving him broader shoulders. Not sure, but I'm actually totally fine with that because although Anubis is certainly an important deity, Horus was also considered to be a warrior. So him being a little bit more larger in stature just seems right to me. Now, back to the collection. My collection is based on nostalgia and my childhood during the late 70s and early 80s. In my Anubis review, I mentioned why I'm drawn to this line of Egyptian-inspired pieces. And considering the significance of Horus in the Pantheon, this was a must-have piece. I won't be purchasing all of the TBLeague Egyptian line, though, as I'm limiting myself to the gods. Like Month, for example, is not a real deity. She was made up by TBLeague, I think, to probably make use of their production capabilities and sort of make profit out of that. Their new Tutankhamun is pretty cool, but that figure would actually go much better with their Nefertiti or Cleopatra figures. And also, I see no need for the new winged versions of Horus, as all the depictions that I've seen of the humanoid Horus at in Egypt at the temples and the tombs, that Horus does not seem to carry wings the majority of the time. So this is the ideal Horus for me. But again, the interesting, unique design that combined with the best seamless bodies in the industry, along with great sculpting, great paintwork, means that this figure certainly is a top shelf collectible. Let me know if you agree in the comments below. Thanks for watching. Definitely subscribe if you want, but for now, it's time to get this collectible back on the shelf.